Good morning. Today, GP and I, Aditi, will be presenting to you our attempt at a spatial history of Tyagaraya Nagar in Chennai. To help us with this, we have used concepts and tools borrowed from Patrick Geddes, Henri Lefebvre, Michel the Certeau, and Pierre Bordieu, as well as Walter Benjamin. Town planning is not mere place planning. Its task is not to coerce people into new places against their associations, wishes, and interests, as we find bad schemes trying to do. Instead, its task is to find the right places for each sort of people, places where they will really flourish. So begins the introduction to Patrick Geddes' report on the towns in the Madras Presidency 1915. So too did we begin, with Geddes. Enthralled with his ideas, we decided to perform a diagnostic survey, or at least attempt one, on T. Nagar. To question people on how they lived, how they had moved there, and why they lived where they did. The plan as it stood was to walk through T. Nagar, observing and having as many conversations as possible. We dug up old maps of Chennai to try and trace the history of the place and locate Geddes' time with respect to our site. We were looking for planning documents, photos, or any kind of material that would tell us what existed in T. Nagar when Geddes was making tours of Indian cities. Though this material did not come to us in the order we are presenting it, we would still like to begin our story with the beginning of T. Nagar, because unlike other locations in Chennai, T. Nagar was a space that was quite literally produced. The map of Madras, as drawn up by the Imperial Gazetteer of India in 1909, is shown here. T. Nagar doesn't exist yet. In its place is a lake called the Long Tank of Mylapore. It's the big blue boomerang, which marks the western frontier of the city and the limits of the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court of the Madras Judicature. In fact, T. Nagar does not emerge from the depths until 1923, when the Long Tank is drained and the administration of the Mamlam Zamindari, in which it was located, is taken over by the city from the local chief. Tyagaraya Nagar is carved out of it. The primary reason is to meet the expanding population's housing needs. Panagal Park is developed at the center of this new locality and named in honor of the then chief minister, the Raja of Panagal. It was planned as a residential area, with many of the streets and roads getting their names from famous dignitaries of the time. From then on, T. Nagar seemed to take on a life of its own. The first retail shop set up in 1928 was that of Nalli Chinnasamy Chetty, and from there on, more and more shops started setting up. Pondi Bazaar too had begun to make its appearance. This evolution gives us the perfect entry point to Lefebvre's triad. The Long Tank is the perceived space. It is the material physicality that existed before T. Nagar was even imagined. Then the Madras Town Planning Act of 1920 presents us with the conceived space of T. Nagar, and finally the mushrooming of a thriving commercial hub in the middle of this conceived space, which today informs all our imaginaries of T. Nagar, fits with the lived space. The social space that brings together the real and abstract space through people's everyday practices, which are then embedded with their own symbolisms and meanings, is created in this process. To understand the production of this social space, we began to look at how T. Nagar was arranged. In the map of T. Nagar as it stands today, we walked through the areas marked in red. Most of this was the commercial hub. The blue lines are the residential and more upper class areas of T. Nagar. What becomes more obvious once we go to the street view is that, as Lefebvre argued, social space is allocated according to class and hence reproduces class structures. He saw this in the context of large tracts of land belonging to the rich, while the poor were condensed into small congested spaces, or through the uneven development in the quality of places. In T. Nagar, a space that is produced by the coexistence and competition between small and big capital, such a divide is developing. The big capital occupies wide expanses of land on the radial roads like G.N. Chetty, Venkat Narayana, and now Tyagaraya Road, while the small vendors and the small shops which comprise the small capital are pushed into the narrow offshoots of the Usman Road, like Ranganathan Street, Natesan Street, and Ramanathan Street. Space is the ultimate locus and medium of struggle, and hence it is a crucial political issue. We see this struggle play out in T. Nagar in the evictions of street vendors and their relocation into the building complex, in the use of police force during all festivals, whose primary function is to control the crowd, and finally in the rationalization being imposed on the streets through the plans for constructing pavements, for freeing vendors, and pushing back shops by removing their encroachments.
Now, Lefebvre keeps saying that you need to understand the dialectics in terms of the material practices. This can be made sense of in T. Nagar in a particular way. So, if you start tracing where everybody gets their goods from, you will eventually end up in Georgetown or in Moore Market. All kinds of clothes and things come from Georgetown. The bells, watches, leather products, utensils, and small plastic products like combs, hand mirrors, all of them. But there is a difference. The hawkers will have to go by themselves to these wholesale shops in Georgetown, take the goods on a credit basis, and then pay the shop owners in Georgetown. However, shops like Sarana stores have a regular contract with these wholesale shops in Georgetown. The sellers from wholesale shops themselves come to T. Nagar and deliver en masse and get a lump sum payment. So by buying on a much larger scale, Sarana stores gets its goods at a much lesser price. So here's the dialectic. Sarana stores, which represents the large capital, is opposed by the sales of the hawkers who represent the small capital. But Sarana stores has overcome this dialectic by opening up branches in places like Kurasevakam. Hawkers have told us about how the crowd in T. Nagar has... On a tangential note, David Harvey would pose the entire process as driven by large-scale finance, which is able to fund the expansion of Sarana stores into outer areas, thereby ensuring that there is no slippage of surplus. At the same time, it is not a simple dialectic between the big and small capital, nor is it simply the struggle between conceived and perceived space. Well, our own notes has stories of people struggling to make claims over the various resources. How do people make these struggles and what do they employ in these struggles?
The lady in the picture here is selling footwearsy, and there was a man behind her selling t-shirts, both on Osman Road. They have been selling their wares for well over 10 years. In this time, as we have seen, they have developed networks that transcend their physical location. These relations between vendors, Sarvana stores, the suppliers in Moore Market, and the final consumers establishes a field as understood in the context of Bordieu. It has its own logic that identifies acceptable and unacceptable actions and dispositions on the part of the social agents. This is the social arena within which the different economic actors are struggling over space in order to get access to the surpluses offered by T. Nagar. We also saw the field presenting us with the type of habitus which dictated to the vendors their position in the field. This was a position of illegality that they affirmed. Going back to the old lady selling putuarsi, in her interview she explained the police raids that occur periodically in T. Nagar with a sense of guilt. She felt that she was indeed performing an act worth being evicted for, hence it was only right the police came and move her out. However, she was also equally certain that she needed to come back as she had no other place to sell her goods and make her livelihood. Thus, practices developed over time have now solidified into routine, whether or not they are considered criminal. The vendors are aware of the stakes of playing the game. They know this means constant raids by the police. The enactment of eviction and reoccupation and their ability to stay put until some major change forces them out of the space and alters the field altogether. Until that time, they plug in and out of the process of production at different points, changing wares with the season and demand, moving their physical location to be visible to the maximum crowd, all the time aware of the field and its limits. They will not choose to refuse relocation, but they will try and rent out the space allotted to them. They will not refuse the bribes or protest police interference, but they will come back the next day after the eviction and continue their trade. In another part of Osman Road, the changing demand of people has served to alter the field occupied by a bookseller. The public no longer has that same demand for reading books as it had in the past, so he has adapted his shop. From what had earlier been a thriving library, he now has shifted to selling his books. However, demand is low even for this, and according to him, today's youth do not value reading and have lost their culture. So we decided that with these narratives, it was now time to adopt a third lens. We moved in the terrain of tactics and strategies. In other words, Michel de Certeau.
According to de Certeau, people in power would employ strategies, while people who don't have access to power would employ tactics. The tactics are spontaneous and they depend on opportunity. We now introduce examples from our fieldwork to understand de Certeau and then go beyond his theory to connect him with other theorists. In the crowded Ranganathan street, you will find men selling earphones or employees of tailor shops standing right in the middle of the road at regular intervals, interrupting the flow of the crowd. These employees are busy giving away visiting cards of their own shops. The crowd, which is really the resource, here is being accessed through these practices of tactics. These collective individual actions make a pattern, just like the footpath that bypasses the road. Now, another relevant instance would be Saravana stores pursuing a strategy to take over the market for consumer goods. In response, the hawkers take to a tactic. They sell different goods during different seasons, thereby cashing in on the changing needs of the people. To quote De Soto on this, tactics has at its disposal no base where it can capitalize on its advantages, prepare its expansions, and secure independence with respect to circumstances. On the contrary, because it does not have a place, a tactic depends on time. It is always on the watch for opportunities that must be seized on the wing. Whatever it wins, it does not keep. It constantly manipulates events in order to turn them into opportunities. In short, tactics privilege time and strategies privilege space. The person performing a tactic does not have a space of his own and occupies various spaces depending on the opportunities that time presents. So in a sense, tactics open up a space for resisting power. However, at the same time, they preclude a range of practices that cannot be caught within the binary of a strategy and tactic and can still subvert power. An example of this kind of practice, we think, would be the sale and consumption of pirate DVDs in the same Tinagar. We know that large production companies, by lobbying with the government, try to prevent copyright violations. They adopt a strategy to contain the consumption of movies within theatres. However, the hawkers selling pirate DVDs in Tinagar and Burma Bazaar have a well-organized network and structure of their own. They have their own space from which they operate and release DVDs on a timely basis so that they can stay up to date. Despite them subverting the larger strategy and tapping into the leakages within the cinema industry, they cannot be characterized as a tactic. So, the confluence of time and space within these kind of practices can be rather better understood using Walter Benjamin's idea of porosity. In his essay on porosity, Andrew Benjamin proposes that we look at the idea of porosity as a spatio-temporal concept. From Benjamin's work, what we see is that the opaque porosity at play in Naples is useful in resisting the imposition of the grid. As much as the street flows into the houses and the houses flow into the street, so do the public and the private. However, this porosity cannot be thought of merely in terms of interconnected rooms. Similarly, merely accounting for time through movement does not help either. Describing the porosity in terms of linear sequential movements through borders implies that a border can be traversed in only one manner. Andrew Benjamin here points out to the technique that Walter Benjamin has used in his essay to overcome this problem. In this quote, note the use of the term at the same time or Zugleich. It introduces a complexity to the moment, and this complexity is useful to rework the idea of the border. While De Soto's tactic was a mere time practice, Benjamin's idea of porosity as a time-space concept helps us to understand the phenomena of pirate DVDs. Pirate DVDs represent a leakage in the virtual space wherein, by the act of buying one of these, the customer simultaneously occupies a Bollywood, Hollywood, and Tollywood market at the same time while still being in Tinagar.